Good evening, and welcome to Listen Here, our weekly program talking about music. And joining me tonight, of course, is music director Rafael Paieri. Welcome, Rafael.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Listen Here.
Beautiful day.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. I'm very excited about tonight because Shostakovich, I know, means a lot to you, as it does to me. And I actually believe that Shostakovich has really found a place in the hearts of our audiences here as they have heard their orchestra, you with the orchestra, play this incredible music.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, the reaction that we have for both 10th and 11th, I remember that it was very, very warm and welcoming. So yeah, I'm a big fan of Shostakovich, so in case that's not shown.
Well, it's interesting because last week we talked about Mahler and building towards Shostakovich. And I think first and foremost, Shostakovich represented the time he was living in. He started as a film composer. I mean, in other words, he played the piano for films, et cetera. Film was a genre that he admired. And he played a really important part in speaking the truth about what was happening in Stalinist Russia, Stalin being a focus tonight, without using words. He made dramatic statements through his music.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, he was a genius for sure. I mean, his first symphony, that when he was only 19 years old, you could see how he was going to be and expand. And he used all those tools with the genre, with film music and the virtuosic piano playing and fantastic orchestration to actually try to always say what he wanted, even when sometimes he would be deep into trouble because of that. But he just remained very truthful to himself, which is remarkable.
Yes, he did get in trouble a few times. And there were nights that he would sleep with the suitcase by the door so that if the officials came to take him away, he wouldn't wake the family.
Yeah. Yeah, it's frightening times. It sounds like it was almost from a movie, but no, just reality. It's one of those.
Yeah, and we talk a little bit about that tonight. After his Lady Macbeth of Mtsensk, his opera,
I think Marta's having a little bit of problems. Maybe, yeah. Yeah, what Marta was saying, of course, with regarding Shostakovich, he got into trouble after his opera. Actually, I think Stalin went to one of his performances and then realized that it was talking about the death of a tyrant. And I don't think that fell very well into it. I don't know if Marta is back now. There was
my back.
Yes, there you are.
I've been listening to you. I'm sorry. No, but, you know, we did a performance of Shostakovich 4, which, of course, was not performed for 20 years, 25 years after he wrote it. But we asked the question at that point, is music dangerous? And in this case, music communicated so viscerally to people that Stalin himself felt this was a threat to his ideals.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I know that there are some footage of Shostakovich's daughter, and that she always talked about that whenever she sees her father listen to his music, he was always very nervous, biting his fingertips and fingernails, just because somehow he thought in his mind that there was a straight connection with what he was saying, and that somehow Stalin could really understand him. Maybe not the Pravda and everybody else, but that Stalin was going to be, and yet he was courageous enough to actually say it, even though it will make him very, very, to be at the tip of the chair, very, very nervous. But yeah, it's fantastic that we could actually explore into his music.
And so many poets, artists were sent away never to be seen again. I mean, this was a time of assassinations and the fear to speak out. And this music has that at its core. One of the other things I think that's wonderful about tonight's program is that three of our musicians speak about their connection to this music. The emotional connection, of course, but also the technical connection. And, you know, when we sometimes talk about orchestration, it sounds like a musical, fancy musical term, but it's, he really uses the sound or his imagined sounds of what an instrument can do. And he stretches the range, therefore, of what an orchestra can sound like.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm using different techniques and combination that they were used before, but not in the same way, creating this new palette of colors that it's just, yeah. It's just, that's why I'm a big fan.
So I think we should begin, and we begin with a taste of his music. And then I also should say we're joined tonight by Jared McBurney. Jared McBurney, as you well know, is one of the world's leading experts on the music of Shostakovich, and including taking fragments of incomplete works and completing them, orchestrating them, and so forth. So it's a treat to have you and Jared talking about this music as well.
Yeah.
So let's hear some Shostakovich.
In 1953, Stalin died, and the effect on that country was vastly complex, and it is very hard for us who have not lived through that experience to understand what it meant that Stalin died, particularly because the terror did not stop then, but it changed. I used to know a wonderful old man. His daughter is a very famous living composer, Elena Firsova. Her father was a nuclear physicist. And Lena once told me that one of her earliest memories was of her father, the day that the death of Stalin was announced. The people poured out into the streets to mourn, because the terror was so great that if you didn't weep, if you didn't show that you were grieving, you might be arrested, you might be killed. All sorts of things could happen to you. Her father, this great scientist, Oleg Firsov, I remember him so well, he went down the stairs in the block of flats where they were living. He walked into the street where the crowds were, and he put his hat on. When somebody dies, you're supposed to take their hat off. He put his hat on and he said, "Tiran Umir, the tyrant has died." And Lena, to this day, she's very much around. She remembers her mother's fear when her father did that. And I would say that Shostakovich's 10th symphony is the equivalent of going into the street and saying, "Tiran Umir, the tyrant has died."
It's not only that the tyrant has died, but what now? Is it going to be okay? And the first movement, which is long and wonderful, and it puts you through this roller coaster of starting and little by little how he comes from that inner thought, that looking at the mirror and looking, it's like, the tyrant has died? I haven't, but now what? How he goes into this, and he portrayed it when he used the bassoons and the contrabassoons. It's just devastating, you know? When we got this amazing thing, and again, and you have the bassoon going in this most melancholic theme and trying to say it again before getting into that big climax. It's, yeah, like you said, it's like film music. He's actually portraying images of everything through the music, and it's, you could, once you know, it's, you don't need the screen, you know? It's like, yeah, that's exactly what it is. That's exactly what he meant.
And you could feel the pain. And one of the most important things, as you know, you live there, is never self-pity. It's like, you know, yeah, we suffer a drink. This is who we are. We get stronger and we move on. It's not about, oh, look at me, poor me. It's not. This is something that you have to live. And that's what they make their soul about. The moment that you start looking at Shostakovich at that kind of self-pity kind of person, you destroy his music. It's become something else.
I agree with you completely that it's not me, me, me. It's something more profound than that. It's something to do with the idea of the individual against the mass. These artists always saw human life as a spider's web in which individual experience is connected to the experience of our species as a whole. And that, I think, was something that that Shostakovich never lost. But in this symphony, that drama plays out with peculiar intensity. To me, I don't know what you think as far as getting the players to play it go, but my great friend and teacher, Alfred Schnittke, told me a story. It's too long to tell now, but the essence of it was that he had heard the Vienna Philharmonic playing Shostakovich, and it was like somebody trying to speak a language, he said, that they didn't speak. And we were in a small group of friends, and one friend of mine said, what was wrong with the way the Viennese were playing? And Alfred said, because when they were playing Shostakovich, they played the notes. We don't play the notes. We play the journey between the notes.
Yeah.
It's a completely different approach. It was certainly true for me when I went to live in the Soviet Union. I had had no understanding of Shostakovich's music really before. And to me, when I heard those players playing, it was like a light going on. I went, oh, it's not a series of notes. It's a journey, a reaching from one note to the next. Do you find it difficult to get people to do that when you're conducting orchestras?
Well, it depends. It's complex, but wonderful. And once you get into that mindset, the sound, everything just changes. Because you could just play, if you see the metronome marking on this whole thing, you could go through many different things. It's like, well, this doesn't make any sense. And if you just play through without having that in between the notes tension that it exists, then it would sound like almost like a carousel music, you know. It would be like, yeah, fine. But when you get that sense and you could put your mind into that kind of mindset, it's a completely different piece.
I can say that the music of Shostakovich has transcended the time, and it's still very fresh, and it's very popular for the audiences and the musicians. Where every time we see Shostakovich in a program, we're like, ooh, juicy, you know, like everybody gets all excited. And the great thing about Shostakovich is that he knows how to write for the instruments so well. He's a genius. And as far as contrabassoon, he writes so well for the instrument and use it for support. It's not so much a soloist, but it's always a supporting and very important times. So we're very excited every time we have to play some piece. And this Shostakovich 10 just has like an example of how good of his writing is.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, when we go into the second movement of Shostakovich 5, it's going to be beam. Bum, bum, bum. It's really great.
It's perfect. It's perfect for contrabassoon. Like that, it's like in the register, and it supports the first bassoon. They are in octaves, so it creates a lot of sound with two instruments, and it's just perfectly written, and it's a pleasure to play.
Yeah, absolutely. And in here, especially in the 10th symphony, we know that he had the bassoon just playing the theme that he borrowed from Mahler's second, that morning light that he puts into a kind of a soliloquy for the first bassoon, and then the thoughts for then you guys come in your solo. It's
I mean that's the preface for the climax of the movement, and he uses the three bassoons, and what a way to start the beginning of the climax with like the two lines, the two themes, like the first theme being the six notes, those six notes, and he states a melody, and then they have the second theme in the first bassoon, and in the first theme, which is like in the basses that I just sung, that becomes the counterpoint of the melody, and it's like a conversation between three people. And the two bassoons, the second and third bassoon, are still with very brooding and foreboding melody. And the first bassoon is in the top two octaves, and he seems like he has hope, and he wants to battle the despair. And, you know, he's very cautionary, but he still wants to, you know, be positive and look towards the future. And the two bassoons are, the two second and third bassoon are trying to bring him down, but, and then, you know, a battle ensues and all the winds play, and then we have the climax, you know, like maybe 40 measures later, you know.
I always love that episode completely, and then, and like you said, you have these two parts that they're just going. The first bassoon goes higher and higher, and the yes. And you guys go lower.
We go lower. Yeah, I think it's very interesting. Like we want to bring the first bassoon down, but he still has, you know, he wants to battle despair.
Something that is will also be fun for the audience to know is how do you prepare or approach when you are in this Shostakovich kind of world? How you put things in mind and all of that.
Yeah. Well, you have to make reeds that are very flexible, and being an auxiliary instrument, sometimes you know, being third bassoon, piccolo, English horn, bass clarinet, we have to wait for very long times and just sit, which is like a blessing. I would say, you know, being a contrabassoon is the best job, because sometimes I don't have to play even for movements, and I just sit there and absorb everything around me. I feel like the luckiest person in the whole world. I have the best seat on the house, just sitting there and just listening my colleagues perform. It's just, I learn so much every time.
That was great. You don't always get to hear the contrabassoon on their own. So
yeah,
it was lovely to hear Leyla. Raphael, Mahler is a complex score, there's no question. For that matter, Beethoven 6 is a complex score, but when you start to work on Shostakovich, and how do you begin? I mean, what do you look for? How do you kind of go into the score, and then how do you balance this, the musical part and the not just the emotion, but the story? How do you communicate also that to the orchestra?
Yeah, well, I mean, before getting into the score, I tried to actually read what was happening during the time that he actually wrote it, having a little bit, of course, going back, and I have a few books from that speaks about Shostakovich, and I always, whenever I'm going back to a score or to study a new symphony, I go back and try to find those little bit of where it was going to happen, and try to see, because he never speak in fragment. He always speak a full story, the whole thing from the first movement to the last one. There's always some underlining. So it's important to know what was in his mind, even with his first symphony. I mean, he was already trying to struggle to make himself be notable, being 19 and making this thesis. He was already playing at the cinema a lot, and he made this wonderful symphony with the piano, a very important part. So to try to get to know, to get his mindset during the time, and then start to explore a little bit, because he, as we said before, regarding his orchestration, he uses different techniques and different colors that they are very characteristic of him, but he always changed something, and it's always they have to do with what he was trying to say and what he was feeling at the moment. And then you try to get that, and then try to explain a little bit to the orchestra. The orchestra, I mean, normally the orchestra know very very well all of this, so it's good to maybe just have a little reminder, a little bit of, let's remember that during this time it was going through this way, and during that time he was doing this. And you could hear like the different kind of camera shots from all of these different things, and then you just have to put them together into the perfect video, which is not a video, but actually it's music and sound. So that's a little bit my process, at least.
That's a really wonderful analogy. That's amazing. Shostakovich gives us clues. I mean, he embeds little parts in the stories. It might be a hymn that everyone who would be listening at that time would know, and they would know what it meant, or it might be something sort of folk song. But in this particular case, we think of Beethoven 5 as having the opening motif, da-da-da-dum. In this, he embeds a kind of also personal message, a personal message, in fact, his name, his the outline of that.
Yes, indeed. And he used it, of course, in his string quartet number 8, having his name into the German notation. It is D-S-C-H, so D it would be the re, or the note D in English. Then the E flat is actually as in German, that is the S. Then the C is C, and the H, or how the German call ha, is the B natural. So they put the re, mi, do, si in Spanish for me, or in English it would be the S-C-H, to try to put the mark. But it's not in a egotistical way to just put his imprint, but in a way to how he survived and how he was doing. Of course, we have Bach that also did it and did fugues under his name, B-A-C-H, the prelude and fugue under the name Bach. It's another thing. But Shostakovich put it into there just as a imprint of survival, of resilience, of that trying to go for it and put it in there into a marvelous way that he then explores and put it into this kaleidoscopic frenzy in the third and last movement.
It's really remarkable. So let's hear some more.
I think Shostakovich symphonies, and particularly the snare drum parts, are some of the most fun things to play and some of the most meaningful snare drum parts, I think, in the repertoire. And you know, this climax point in the first movement, you hear it for much time prior, and you're sitting and kind of waiting. It's actually the first entrance that you play, and it's just a massive climax after all this time that's passed, and you're just waiting to come in, right there and to play that rhythm very forcefully, very intently, with a lot of intensity. And so it's an incredible moment. To be sitting and then all of a sudden get up and really, really go for it. You really have to go for it in this place. There's no way getting around it. You just have to stand up and boom, right on there. And it's just a fantastic moment for the snare drum. And, as a player, you're very, very excited. You're on stage and there's such an excitement and an energy, but you have to sort of, control it. If you don't control, your excitement, it ends up, you can start playing too fast and too, maybe too loud, too forcefully. And so in a controlled, excited way, you just sort of attack it.
Yeah. And it's great. And it's not like a little bit, it's really long. And bam, 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 bam. You get more and more and everybody there before the orchestra kind of scream. It's wonderful, of course.
I was thinking about, playing this, and I hadn't thought about the 10th Symphony, and, since we played it last, and it immediately came back to me. you feel, you know, that all that energy and intent and, you know, all that fantastic, you know, sound that existed from so long ago. And it's really amazing for it to just immediately come back to you. So that was fun to revisit a little bit up in my upstairs bedroom here.
I hope your neighbors are okay. Yeah.
they probably thought, what on earth is going on over there right now?
Yeah, and then of course we go into the second movement, that it's we have this kind of portrait of Stalin everything, but playing in the piccolo snare drum is always wonderful. Remembering seeing you and have that wonderful connection, bagadam, bagadam, that it's so great. Your part is, I have never played a snare drum, but I feel that it must be so much fun to interact there.
It's really incredible. You know, the orchestra's playing very, very fast. It's this, you know, fast allegro scherzo movement, just insistent, you know, 16th notes going really, really fast. And, you know, as a player, you know, you're trying to listen and try to exactly that, just exactly in the right spot. And, you know, with the acoustic that we have being, you know, upstage right, and trying to watch you in this case, trying to time it and everything. But yeah, the 16th notes are just this like machine gun, consistent, aggressive, into the drum. You know, it's not Capriccio Espanol where it's very, very light. I mean, this is like really, you're really pounding this part. That's the character of the sound. And, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, I think most people would know that the music is programmatic and, you know, much of the symphonies are depicting a not nice moment in human history in another part of the world. But if you just even void of knowing that, if just listening to the music, you really get a feeling and a sense of this angst. It's a real joy to play, but at the same time, you know, really trying to place the notes exactly as they happen. You know, the horns, the bells are facing us. So there's the wall. You kind of get this, you know, you hear a lot of horn sound, which is great. You know, it's quite gratifying, truthfully. It really is to be right in the middle of it.
Yeah. It's wonderful. It's always, I have this kind of picture of it in the second movement, that it's just a tank. It doesn't matter what is in front of it. It just keeps going and it's kind of run out. Anything that is against it, just go for it. And the snare drum has a lot of to do with it, that just, you could feel how it just, it doesn't matter what is in front, a tree or whatever, it's just going to keep going. It's wonderful. I mean, I will have a lot of fun living through those craziness and more to come for sure. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No, I can't wait. You know, yeah. I'm getting stir crazy not being able to go come in and play, you know, every day. It's just,
I know.
You know, live music, you just do not, you know, you just don't get the energy. You know, there's so much energy at live performance. You have to be there in the room with the orchestra. Everybody's playing. Everyone at the same time is trying to make some moment happen. And it's just, it's an irreplaceable, you know, thing that, you know, I just can't wait to get back to doing that, because it's just a phenomenal feeling. It's something I've been missing, for sure.
Let's say something about the second movement, which is very short.
Yeah.
4 minutes or?
4.5 minutes, yeah.
I remember hearing that on one occasion. I had taken a friend, she was the girlfriend of my brother, to a concert, and she was not expecting it. And she heard that movement and she just burst into tears because it's so frightening.
She has this monster that whatever is in front of it is just going to run over. And you have this thing that it never stops. You have the expansion of the first movement that is like 17 minutes long. You have this and you have the wooden bird in there. And then you got the tyrant coming in. My image is like a tank. It doesn't matter what is in front, if it's rock, if it's flesh, if it's bone, it's just going to run over. But it's only 4.5 minutes. On a 60-minute symphony, it's like, yes, I've been afraid of you all my life, or kind of fighting inside me, being brave inside, but cannot be out because then, you know, you're stronger and you will use all your force on me. And I'm just going to give you 4 minutes of terror. And then will spin into the third movement when he actually put his name, I think it's 33 times that he write his exact name, you know, re mi do si, having it into there, and put it into so many different layers. You have the horn with the big question mark. I remember telling the orchestra, there's a moment that, because he was condemned to only write propaganda music, film music, circus music, and he have this kind of circus style, malabaristic, in the middle of the third movement. You have this whole thing before getting the orchestra into the big climax, and then he put his name. And the way I like to describe it to the orchestra is like, imagine that he's putting himself in watercolors and then throw a bucket of water on the whole thing, and you have the whole thing, his whole self just going fading completely before getting the horn again to make the question. It's so wonderfully devastating.
I'd like to say something about the question mark.
Yes, of please. Dear.
For a long time, when the 10th Symphony was first performed, one of the early Soviet critics said, there is this strange horn call which happens 12 times. It seems to have some kind of significance, but nobody progressed beyond that for a long time, until in the 1990s, a Soviet musicologist called Nelly Kravitz, who went to live in Israel, she discovered that there was an old lady composer living in Tel Aviv, I think she was, who was a pupil of Shostakovich long before, in the 1950s. She was from Azerbaijan, and her name was Elmira Nazirova. So she went to interview Elmira Nazirova about her time with Shostakovich. And there she heard a very strange story. Miss Nazirova said, who was a grandmother by that stage, she said, yes, I was a student of Shostakovich when he was writing the 10th Symphony. And he asked me for a photographic portrait of me. And then he started writing me letters. And in one particular letter, he told me he had put my name 12 times in the slow movement of the 10th Symphony. And Nelly said, where is this letter? And Elmira Nazirova, who was an old lady by this stage, she said, well, I didn't want my husband to see it at the time, so I put it inside the piano in the frame, and I stuck it with scotch tape to the underside of the piano, so beneath the strings. So Nelly said, what happened to your piano? And Elmira said, it's right behind you. It's in the room. And Nelly Kravitz said, well, what happened to the letter? And she said, I don't know. Perhaps it's still there. So they opened the piano, and it was still there. And she brought out the letter. And there is the letter. I've seen the letter. I have seen a copy of the letter. It's been published now. And he says two things in there. It's a love letter. He says, I've put your name 12 times. Elmira. I la mi re a. Elmira. So going back to what I said about the public and the private, we have the extremely public and the extremely private, because the significance of the horn call, the question mark, as actually the name of this woman. And there it is. And Nelly Kravitz, at the end of her interview, she said to Elmira, did you stay in touch with Shostakovich? And she said, no. He wrote to me to tell me he'd finished the symphony, and I never heard from him again. And Nelly said, why do you think that was? And she said, because I had served my purpose in his imagination. He was finished.
That Elmira story is amazing and so personal. And that beautiful horn call takes on this kind of new story after you hear that.
Yeah. And it says a lot of how Shostakovich's mind works. It's a why 12 times? Like, because there's something very beautiful with the first theme of the first movement that he uses a Mahler theme. And then in here, if you, even though it's a love letter for his mischievous other part, 12 times, but then you cannot stop thinking about the 12 chimes in Zarathustra when it comes down before getting this whole thing. Wonderful. It never stopped to amaze me with Shostakovich. It's great.
Well, and the shifts in mood in these last two movements that we've just listened to, and of course, you know, with the amazing visuals that Mike Tutai has included, it really kind of brings you into that time and what he was thinking, and this kind of giddiness, the clowns against this driving militaristic terror. The music takes you there, even without the visuals, but with them, really kind of harkens into his time, into the time he lived through.
Absolutely, yeah.
And I think also just, we talk about kind of what's Russian in music. We talked about Tchaikovsky a few weeks ago, but the soul of the people, so connected to the music, so understanding of what he was trying to say.
Yeah,
as absolutely. We said earlier.
Yeah, and with no, even though there's a lot of sour cream on it, nothing is fake. It could be heavy, you know, like a good mushroom soup, but nothing fake. Just always everything out there, yeah.
And Greg Cohen, I'd love to be able to play that snare drum solo as well. And it's just palpable. I think every time we see our musicians, when I see them with you talking about music, it's not the same as making music, but it gets you closer, which is, you know, you can just tell how much everybody really wants to be able to return to live music as soon as possible.
Oh, yes, yeah. Where I think everybody here, I mean, listening, and then later on, we are very hungry and thirsty for coming back to what we know that we can do, hopefully not too long.
Yeah. So next we go to Sarah Skuster and beautiful oboe, our principal oboe, and the beautiful oboe solos.
One of the fun things for me about playing Shostakovich is the sort of energy, the raw energy that you get from playing that piece. And I'm thinking in Shostakovich 10, like the second movement, is just literally, I mean, it's supposed to be a portrait of Stalin. So it's just like raw rage. And it's so invigorating to be playing on stage with everybody.
Even though we could get, you know, like very dark images of it, but you have that feeling and that drive. And it,
right.
Yeah. And you have a beautiful, fantastic solo in the fourth movement. So,
you know, Shostakovich really blessed the oboe with all these solos. I mean, there's that beautiful solo in the beginning of the fourth movement. There's also, you know, the beautiful solo in the third movement of the fifth symphony. Symphony number one has a huge oboe solo in the slow movement. Most of the solos for the oboe seem like they want to, they're all these sort of pale colors, ghostly. And it's sort of like he really wants to portray loneliness and suffering and pain, which I think the oboe's tone, like the pungency of the tone is well suited for that. You know, we get the chance to create all these colors that are heart-wrenching, but also really rewarding to play. Like you were saying with the second movement, it's very dark, but also very invigorating and exciting.
Yeah, that solo in the third movement of the fifth is wonderful always.
It's interesting too. A lot of those solos, like I mentioned in the first symphony and the fifth symphony and this symphony, the 10th symphony, they're also often required for auditions. So playing those, of course, I want to communicate the same sort of things, whether I'm playing it as an excerpt in an audition or if I'm playing it in an orchestra, you know, for a live audience. But for the auditions, you really have to sort of make sure you put everything in place and keep it there so that you can play it the same every single time, because of course the audition committee will probably ask for it more than once. But the really rewarding thing about playing it in the orchestra is that you get to react to what the strings are doing, or, you know, be inspired by your colleagues and do something a little different each time, create a different color each time.
Yeah, and it's kind of like a spotlight all the time that you have this, especially for the 10th that you have this whole thing. But maybe what would be interesting for the audience is how do you prepare, or what do you think about in this thing? Because of course, we on stage, we know different things that needs to be on, but maybe it might be a good for the audience to have a sneak peek of what happened in our heads, you know?
Sure, I mean, there's basically two sides to this. One is the technical side, which is basically managing the oboe so that it will do what I want it to do, and so I can communicate what I want to communicate. So of course, for that technical side, it's having a reed that will be stable enough to sit up in the high notes and to sort of hold up against the dynamic extremes of the solo. And also one that's flexible enough to change colors and, you know, sort of get through the solo and communicate also. So there's that. There's always the reed making with oboe. But in terms of the music, with Shostakovich, it's more just communicating raw emotion. And in this case, I would say it's a whole range of sort of pain, loneliness, forbearance, I would say, defiance, all these things that I think, you know, he was communicating and experiencing in his life. And I would say specifically in this solo, there's a part at the end where it's a very huge outcry, and it's supposed to sound like sort of just raw and very sort of torn from you. And then the very next part is exactly the same notes and the same phrase, but pianissimo, so very quiet, as if you've sort of said everything you need to say and then there's nothing left and everything's very cold and pale. And I think that's so unique for Shostakovich, and it's so satisfying to be able to communicate that. It's interesting because there's a great oboist long ago, Marcel Tabuteau, who was basically the father of American oboe playing in the Philadelphia Orchestra for many years. And he had a saying that was, you want to play with your head, not with your heart. And that doesn't mean you don't experience and, you know, interact with the emotions of the piece, but that you also have to be in control and have a plan and know what you want to say beforehand and practice it, of course, so you know it'll come across clearly. And so I would say when you're playing this music, we work on it so much that we get to that point where we're in control and we're playing it with our heads so we can communicate the heart part of it to the audience.
Yeah, because of course it's important that you master the technique, being able to actually express what you want without interrupting the message.
I agree. You know, that whole solo is such, it's like a soliloquy that a great actor would give with so much range of highs and lows and emotion and just technique. And yeah, I keep saying emotion, but it's such a key thing for Shostakovich. It's true, it's not as easy as it sounds, but it's so rewarding.
What about the last movement?
The last movement is Shostakovich's optimistic view, in a way. And I put this into quotation because I think it was his way in his mind to look down the tyrant's grave and say, like, I survived and you didn't. And even though you changed many things around me, I outlive you. And now you're there, rotting, and I'm here standing. I mean, you have the very slow introduction before getting into the super virtuosic allegro. But you have pam 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 pam
That's the Freilachs. Yeah. I mean, can you imagine?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's the wedding dance.
Absolutely. And yet, because he was sent to be just a film composer, just a film composer. After the ninth, as we know, it's like, we cannot take you serious anymore. You can only do things for propaganda, and that's it. And he goes back to the terror, you know? Pam pam pim pam 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 pam. And then his name, re mi do si pam pam, boom, complete. Like finally screaming and almost jumping on top of this theme. And then you have this theme in the cellos after this really, really the biggest climax of the symphony, having this name scream in unison from the whole orchestra. And yet his inner thought, pim pam 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 pim pam 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 pam, the brass, re mi do si. And then he changed, I survive. Pim pam 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 pam, and use the bassoon, pam pam pim pam 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 pim pim pam 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 pim pam pam pim pim pam pam pam. Like, you thought that I could just juggle, you know, that I could just be sent to this small thing. I survive, and look what I do with you. Pam pam, he puts his name, re mi do si, pam 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 pam, until the whole orchestra ends with klezmer dance, fantastic celebration, and it's over. It's like, okay, this is my optimism. Yes, I suffer, but I'm resilient. I outlived you, and I could move on. Maybe not, but from this space, at least, I'm just pushing forward. It's great. His sarcasm is and cynicism is just, I love it.
One of the problems with a regime that tries to control the content of art is that it's almost impossible to control the tone of voice. The tone of voice is not a fact. It's communicated by agreement, by social agreement between us. When you and I look each other in the eye, we don't even know when we're teasing. When we see a laugh, then we know. But it's a fascinating aspect of all works of art that they are performative, and in the act of performance, the question of tone of voice is completely elusive. One Soviet composer once said to me, I asked him if he thought that Shostakovich was parodying socialist realism in one of his big pieces. And this Soviet composer looked at me and he roared with laughter and he said, you're a typical Westerner. You don't understand. You cannot parody socialist realism because it is its own parody already.
Right.
So he said to me, you have to understand that by imposing socialist realism, the ideologues of the regime thought that they were limiting the content of art. But in point of fact, they gave an enormous present to the artists.
I love the ending there, and I love this sentiment that you can't control the art, you can't control the personal expression, that it comes straight through, that he couldn't be stopped really in what he had to say and what people needed him to say and looked to him to say. It's so powerful.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Yeah.
And I think you summed it up perfectly at the end about saying, and I survived.
Yeah, I mean, it's you could hear his sarcasm. You could actually have him I remember there was something, the time for his fifth symphony, talking about my business is rejoicing, that they were used to have that cheers kind of saying, like, let's drink for nothing get any better, because if, you know, if this is what this is get, and we are to, supposed to be as rejoiceful as possible, so let's make it not to be any better than that. So that sarcasm going in there and looking down and say like, yeah, I'm still here.
Yeah, and yet you're right, but a sense of the life force of some optimism that, you know, we can survive this, we can thrive, especially if we hold together. I mean, I think you just feel that all the way through this piece.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
So next week, we're planning on continuing Shostakovich with his 11th symphony, which was the last piece you conducted with this orchestra, yeah, as I recall.
Absolutely.
And I can still hear those chimes ringing at the end. So it will. We have yet a lot more to talk about in terms of, you know, going from 10 to the 11th symphony next week.
Yeah, I'm looking forward. And also remember that it was the last symphony that I conducted since I was 39 and my first symphony being 40. So that's also still in there.
I remember. That was quite a birthday.
Yeah. Yeah, so fun to explore and relieve those memories that are still ringing out here. Yeah.
So we invite you all back next week, and we also encourage you to find your favorite recording of this symphony. Now I just want to go out and hear it again in its entirety and kind of whet your appetite. And this is available on Symphony Stream going forward, so you can listen and you can come back and relive some of these things. I think the more we know, the closer we can come to a piece of music, and that's really our goal with this series. So Rafael, it's good to see you. Thank you so much.
Good to see you too. And thank you everybody for tuning in and rewatching it later on.
Great.
All right.
Bye-bye.